Basically, we are very, very excited to welcome to the stage Erin Leonard. Erin and I met a few weeks ago at an event that she was hosting, and I just thought she was just a dynamic speaker and someone who really, really, truly was unleashing her creativity in a very positive and powerful way. So I invited Erin to speak at Creative Year Ever as a keynote for today. So Erin is going to keynote. There you are, Erin. Thank you. You popped up in my feed here.
Well, thank you, Scott. It's so nice to be here. And yes, and I wanted to say, let's start by saying Happy New Year.
Yeah, all right.
Wait
I was gonna buy some New Year stuff and I totally ran out of time, kind of thing. Yeah, I lo love it.
It's okay. I'm still in the New Year's mentality over here in my small apartment in Washington, D.C. We still got the disco balls out, and Christmas lights still up as well because the holidays are not quite over.
Yeah, we unfortunately took all of our Christmas decorations down on Friday. So I didn't want to, but it wasn't my decision. So,
I think my neighbors are ready for me to take down my hall decor. Which is, so I think I may have to do that later today.
yep. So, Erin, just give me one second here. I'm sorry. As you all
Sure.
know, I'm everything here. I'm the tech. I'm trying to do everything at once here, so just give me a second to pull up.
It's no problem at all. And I have my own slides, so I can pull those up and share those.
Yeah, go ahead and pull those up while I'm doing this, please.
All right. Can you see my screen?
Yes, I can.
Fantastic.
All
I'm
right,
gonna hit
let's see
present
here.
so they look a little nicer. How's that?
It looks great. So let's see here. And of course, the website is. The one thing I've learned about this weekend is the website hosting I have it on needs to be faster. The website's been really slow all weekend. So, Erin is going to talk to us today about tapping into your creative superpower and turbocharging your business and career, which is exactly precisely the type of stuff we're talking about this weekend, and something I'm really super excited to hear about Erin talk about. Really, you're creative as Erin talks about. She is a professional. She's a communications meetings person. Erin, I'm gonna let you do your talk. I don't have your professional. I don't. I'm just gonna mention. I'm not doing professional introductions. I want you all to introduce yourself. It's not so typical when you're a keynote, but Erin is ultimately a fantastic professional and someone who I admire and looking forward to have her bring her today. So Erin, I'm gonna shut up and let you take it away. So thank you so much.
Well, thank you so much, Scott. It's amazing to be here on what is this, January 3rd, a year full of potential. Though I know not much has changed since midnight struck on New Year's Eve, but I am so excited to be here with you today. Thank you, Scott, for this incredible program you've put together and for this really inspiring and exciting event. So I'm really excited to see you all. Good morning. Happy Sunday morning. And let's first celebrate by saying, I just want to say thank you for being here. And first things first, Happy New Year. I know I already said it, but it is such a big deal. We did it. We did it. And there's so much more to come in this year, especially if you are planning to have your most creative year ever. By coming today on a Sunday in January, while I'm still in my own holiday mindset, you are showing up for yourself, which is the best thing you can possibly do to jumpstart your year, jumpstart your career, your business. And more than anything else, I want to thank you for being here and for taking the time out of, your day, but also for I want to thank you for making room for yourself and finding the time to be here. So thank you. You are awesome. It's just amazing to meet you. My name is Erin Leonard. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my story. But the first thing that I really want to focus on is the fact that you have a superpower. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about how you can tap into your own personal superpower to turbocharge, or rather, maybe supercharge your business, your career, and have your most creative year ever. Now, I know all of the speakers have been really fantastic, and a lot of these speeches build on one another. So there's some other great stuff that happened yesterday and happens later today that I strongly suggest you also attend, like finding your why and automating things, writing great blog posts, fantastic content all around. But first, let's recognize the fact that you, yes, you have a superpower. okay? You have a power that is absolutely, truly unique to you. This is your talent, your skills. You have a unique experience, a personal journey, a biography. You have learned lessons the hard way, sometimes the easy way. You have experienced a variety of skills, jobs, environments. You've worked with all kinds of different people. And because of that, you have a through line in your life that is present throughout your entire career, but also in your outside of your career. You're something deeper and bigger than just work that drives you to do what you do every single day, and something that drives you to be happy. So you have unique talent, skills, expertise, experience, perspective, and a personal journey that is completely your own. And within that, you do have special skills, but I want you to focus on really one awesome special skill that is unique to you in many ways because it comes from that personal life journey. What is that skill that transcends industry, location, that might be the same thing you find yourself doing time and time and time again, even though you're in a completely different field or a completely different part of your life? What is it that you keep going back to that you're both really good at and like doing? Now, I know that we all have stuff we like doing that we're not necessarily good at. We may become good at those things by learning them, spending more time on them. That's great. You always develop those new skills. Like I said, you can have lots of superpowers, but for today, we're gonna focus on the one that's gonna help you leverage your career into something more creative and better fit for you so that you can launch into the stratosphere and have an incredible life journey doing what you love to do. So we're going to start by talking about finding your why. And the truth of the matter is that I found my why about a year and a half before I even thought of starting my own business. It transformed my life. It was a deeply personal experience. And it was something that in many ways blew my mind. One of my favorite philosophers, not a real pick-me-up kind of guy, but anyway, Soren Kierkegaard says, life can only be understood backwards, yet it must be lived forwards. So the truth of the matter is, looking back upon your life, you likely have that thing, that skill set, that special something that has been propelling you forward that also is aligned with your true deep passion. So we're going to get into this. Let me first by more formally introducing myself. I'm Erin Leonard. It's so nice to meet all of you. I love seeing your faces on the Zoom. Thanks for those of you online on there. And for those of you not, I also get it. My desk is in my kitchen and it can be really hard to be on camera sometimes, especially when the dog and the others are walking around the apartment. So please don't feel embarrassed if you're not on camera. Be comfortable. This is your time. I'm Erin. I am the founder and CEO of my own business, Erin Leonard Events, a really creative name, I know. Well, I never expected to start my own business or to even work in business or enjoy business. I'm really, at the end of the day, an event planner. And that was not my calling in life. That was not what I wanted to grow up when I was a little kid. When I was a little kid, I wanted to be an astronaut or a pilot or, you know, president. And actually that president dream grew more and more and more as I started to get older. And when I left, I'm originally from New Orleans. And when I left home and traveled far away to Boston for college, the first thing I did was involve myself in local campaigns. It was my first job, actually. It was part of a co-op program at my university, Northeastern University, which I attended for this exact reason. While you're in school, they set you up with co-ops, 6-month full-time jobs you have to do instead of coursework. Now you have to land these jobs, you have to interview at these jobs, and then you have to do the work. So this also helped me understand what career path I wanted to take, in that I started in psychology and noticed I didn't want to go into any of the psychology co-ops. They did not sound interesting to me, which made me realize maybe I didn't want to do that every single day of my life. So I pursued a very different major. I actually pursued cultural anthropology because I realized I just love people. Now, I also knew that you know, major didn't necessarily come with a clear job in mind. It was really a something to learn, to grow, a real true liberal arts degree and social science degree in that regard. Very writing and reading intensive, but not something that aligned very closely to what I was going to do every single day for the rest of my life. But that was because I already knew what I was going to do. I already landed my first co-op and absolutely loved it, working in a city councilor's office in Boston, working to solve problems for people throughout the city, working to attend community meetings and learn what was troubling different people in different parts of the city, understand the process of how laws are made, understand how, you know, bills become laws, and how those laws can then impact others. It was an incredible journey. It lasted several years. He ended up running for mayor. I got to work on his campaign. And in my first 6 months ever working for this guy, ever working in City Hall, it dawned on me that, you know, all of the public hearings where we expect people to come and show up and share their time and give their perspective and ask for things they want take place at City Hall Monday through Friday between 9 a.m. and 5 p.m. The exact same hours people work jobs. So it just didn't make any sense to me. I would go to these community meetings and I'd say, why don't you guys come to the hearing and talk about this? The counselors need to hear this. They need to hear it. They'd say, I can't show up. I'm on disability or I have a full-time job. I can't leave between the hours of 9 and 5 and come to some random hearing scheduled on a random day that may not even change anything. I'm telling you now that you've asked me, this is what we need. Go do it. But the truth is, the counselors do need to hear from people in order for more than one counselor to want to get on the same page and want to pass these laws. So I actually was part of planning the first ever public hearing outside of City Hall. We did it in Roxbury, Boston, an underserved, low-income community. We did it outside of regular business hours. We actually did it on a Friday at 5:30 p.m. to 7 p.m. with food and childcare provided. We did it at a handicap accessible location that was attached to a church and community center that was frequented by folks that lived in that neighborhood. And the people that came were the folks that could basically walk to the community center. We had an overflowing audience. Hundreds of people showed up. The city councilors were floored. They could not believe the things they were hearing. It was incredible in that it showed me that the main problem that I was facing that I could also help solve in some ways had to do with access. And just simple fact of bringing people together in a room to talk, to share, to connect can actually create transformational change. So that was just one part of my life journey. I then went on to graduate school, move to DC, intern at the White House as part of the Obama administration. It was absolutely incredible. Got to see some amazing things up close and work on things there full time. And then I landed a job at a consulting firm. A communications firm where I was able to cut my teeth in all kinds of different things and really gravitated towards any of the events that they did. I wanted to lead these events. I wanted to focus on what was the point of this event? How are we engaging people? How are we thinking about access? And at the White House, I did the same thing. I did these community events all over the country that were about getting the feedback from people that would to lawmakers to help change the laws and create the change that people wanted to see. So reflecting on my career a few years into it, I kind of kept going back to doing events. Now, for a long time, I didn't want to be pigeonholed as an event planner. But then I realized that events are so much more than just a day or a conference or a trip somewhere. Events are often holidays or weddings or these very memorable experiences. But as someone that was planning conferences, political things, community meetings, I really found that events in the broad sense are rare moments to connect with others, to step out of our day-to-day lives, connect deeper with ourselves, and in many ways, think about and speak about what we want to happen. And this actually was revolutionary for me, a big revelation in many ways, in that events are something that are needed by across industries, across fields, and they really can be empowering, life-changing experiences. Now, not everyone is going to be, don't get me wrong, but, and it's not going to be that way for every single attendee, But even just reaching one or two people and actually inspiring them, actually connecting with them, or actually being able to bring their change to fruition is incredible. It's incredibly powerful. It's beyond reason. And, you know, within my own limited capacity as one person in the world, I think this is the biggest way I can have the biggest, best impact, is by connecting with folks virtually, in person, but in these rare moments where we all take a break and come together and reflect, learn, and grow as a group. So, needless to say, I'm sorry for that bit of a long journey there to say my superpowers really are community building and organizing, problem solving, creativity, and giving my all. I work really, really hard at things. People know that I'm going to, you know, make a success happen because I will die trying, but also mostly finding and spreading joy. I want people to feel good. I want to make a world that helps more people. You know, I want to help people feel inspired, motivated, ready, and more connected. We're social creatures. So this connects my interests of anthropology, politics, corporate, you know, and the day-to-day, the fact that I have to have a job, right? I have to have a job that makes money, that allows me to pay for my expensive tiny apartment and so many other things in life, my student loans. I've never been afraid of investing on or taking a chance on myself. And I will say for the most part, that's really, really, really worked out in my life in many ways, because I was willing and able to take the risk after I had already kind of created a safety net. And additionally, of course, I'm a very privileged person with a lot that I've learned, a lot of amazing opportunities in my life, but I also am not someone that's independently wealthy. I'm not someone that was innately drawn to business, but it turns out that all of my superpowers are perfectly aligned for having my own business and creating events, hence the name. Aaron Leonard Events. Not very creative, I know, but sure does get to the point. So my why is that events are rare opportunities to step out of our busy lives, grow, learn, reflect, and develop lasting connections. Because of that, I design unique, engaging events that I try to make as fun to plan, which is notoriously hard, as fun to plan as they are to attend. Now, this past year was, of course, absolutely crazy. It's had a lot of ups and downs. I never could have predicted this. It was kind of a challenging time to be in my first year of business, of course, but it was challenging for everyone. And not only for these business reasons, but also emotional reasons, stress, the world, larger society, the grief, the pain of this past year, the isolation. It's been really hard. Now, for my business, though, it's actually been pivotal. This has been our greatest year ever. It's been the year that I transformed from being a solo freelancer to an actual business owner, which was one of my goals that I knew early into starting my business, but I wasn't sure how long that would take. So I've got a lot to share here to mostly say that compared to 2019, I started my business on May 29th of 2019. Compared to 2019, in 2020, despite the fact that events were canceled around the globe, March 11th or 15th or whatever of 2020, you know, my entire event world came crashing down. I had a plan to I usually traveled all around the country. I was in the process of either planning and working on or executing in-person events all over the country. I was traveling to site visits in Las Vegas, Orlando, Boston, Indianapolis. I traveled all the time. I was probably home only 2 weeks every month. So 2020 has been the year of heaven for my dog and all of our dogs, I'm sure. But my world came to a grinding halt, just like everyone else's. It was scary. It was extremely hard. But at the other side of it, when I look at this, there's actually something amazing here. So you can see my journey, to giving it TMI from my QuickBooks. But you can see that in 2020, in November, where I had this stellar month, I did more business in November of 2020 alone than all of 2019. I did $70,000 worth of revenue in November. Now, compared to the 6 months prior of 2019, I only did $60,000 worth of business in the whole year. So this was not the year I expected by any means, but additionally, it wasn't the year I expected in the sense that my goal was to more than double my 2019 business. I wanted to make about $150,000 in revenue in 2020. Felt like that was a fairly reasonable goal. It more than doubled my 6 months in business. And in March, I wasn't sure if that was going to happen. I wasn't sure if I was going to have a business. So really delighted that I exceeded my goal, our target of $100,000. Yay, you know, but so much more to go. So my timeline is really that I started my business by first discovering my why back in 2017. I was actually at a conference. It was an event I was helping to work on. I read Find Your Why by Simon Sinek, completed the workbook. It was actually, again, an assignment we gave to conference attendees. Happened to have a whole bunch of books left around and needed to make some slides to back up the presentation. So said, why don't I go ahead and read this book? Greatest decision I ever made in my life. So found my why, pitched to my employer several months later, about a year later, could I maybe transition to being a consultant? Now, I worked at a consulting firm in DC. This was fairly common here. And I'm originally from New Orleans, where I had never even heard of a consultant. I would have no idea how to define what it is that they do. It's such a DC thing. But where I was working in my field, this was pretty common, that people would move to consulting gigs either to offboard and to move into their own direction or move into a new field or a new job, or just as part of their own career transition. So I made that pitch and it was not particularly well received, I will say. I'm really young. I'm not as young as I look, I'm 34, but my employer said, you're really young for this. I don't understand why we would wanna go for this. How in the hell would this benefit us? We kept talking. They actually encouraged me to file LLC paperwork so that they're saying if I was going to do this to protect my assets, which was a really incredible tip. In March, I did revisit the conversation with them and say, look, I'm really dead serious about this. Can we please do it? Because I'm going to leave no matter what. And this is a great way for you to still have access to me and to help me launch my new undertaking. I'm definitely leaving no matter what. So it really did have to come down to me having that hard line in the sand. Throughout that process, of course, I was trying to save money, but paying off student loans and debt and living in an expensive place hasn't worked out all that much, but I did save a small amount to at least help get me through. I saved about 2 or 3 months of rent. And I did need some money for startup. So I was actually able to have about $5,000 on hand to start up my business. And like I said, about $5,000 for rent and expenses. So I had a total of about $10,000 in savings that I used. And that was it. I mean, in my checking account, I had about $1,000. So I was really a little bit nervous. So I set my last day. My last day there was actually May 28th. It was after a whole bunch of events. They wanted me to get through a major busy spring, which I was happy to do. I was able to then start my business on May 29th. And then I slowly started creating my business. I really didn't have something. I had a name and I had LLC paperwork, and I had my why, but I didn't know if what I really wanted to do was events or something else. So I kind of worked on that for a while I transitioned as a consultant to my old employer. So that was a lot of what was able to help me get started, was that I had a steady income from a previous employer, not nearly what I was making or anything like that, but essentially a small retainer client. And that small savings allowed me to really get the space I needed to figure out what I wanted to do. And then of course, work my butt off to get there. So from there, it went pretty fast. I designed a logo in September, created a website, and then opened a speakers bureau because I realized that that's mostly that I was thinking about what did I need as an event planner that just wasn't out there. And one of them was getting access to affordable speakers. That's a really hard thing to find, good, affordable speakers. They're usually expensive, famous, maybe good, depends on your budget. And then at the very end of the year, I landed my first standalone client. This was major for me and it was revelatory. It was a very small contract for only about $5,000 to redesign a website for a speaker. and establish more of a social presence. So again, that was what I had just done for myself. It's not something that was traditionally in my own, you know, wheelhouse, but I had just launched my own business, developed my own website. And websites are something I had dabbled in here and there for a long time prior to that. So I took a gamble on myself and I got a really good contractor, someone I knew in my network, to build a stellar, stellar website for this client and crush our first ever project. So I was able to hire my first freelancer in January of 2020. I then relaunched my website. So as while we were working on that client's website, I took my simple website I had stood up by myself in Squarespace and hired my team, my consultant and myself basically, to redo our own, my website, and turn it into something that was stellar and beautiful. I'm really quite proud of what the website is today. But that was really fun to both launch a client website and relaunch my own website on kind of the same timeline. And there was a little bit of efficiency there. So had a busy year planned, lots of in-person events. On March 7th, a major event I was working on in DC for 2,500 people had made the difficult decision to cancel their in-person event because of coronavirus. Now, this was before the pandemic was declared, and this was because of the location of the event. It was at a place where a COVID outbreak had just happened. So the client said, there's absolutely no way we are going to bring 2,500 people to a COVID outbreak location. We absolutely have to move virtual, and I want to keep our same event dates. So we had less than 10 days to pivot their entire conference virtual. Now, this is a conference I had been working on for over a year and had worked on for years prior. It was one of my freelance contracts through my old employer. It was a client I knew really well, content I knew really well. And we were able to pivot by keeping the keynotes live on their scheduled dates and times, including Stacey Abrams, which was pretty awesome. Keeping them at their scheduled dates and times, doing them as virtual webinars and rolling out workshops in batches as we were able to pre-record and get those done. So that we were able to have about 25% of the content on the event dates and the remaining 100% of the content within a month of the event in batches. So it went live in groups. Now, this is also while the pandemic was starting. People didn't know what was going on. A lot of people were very upset that the event was canceled. It was extremely stressful, but incredibly stellar that we were able to deliver a great virtual experience very, very quickly. And a lot of that was in getting strategic and bringing it down. So after that, all of my events were canceled. My contract was pretty much ended with my old employer. I launched my first newsletter in hopes to get my name out there more, to share more about what I did, and also reconnect with people because I was feeling very isolated from quarantine. Only a few days later, I landed some major work that changed my life forever, including the National Charter Schools Conference, which also had to move virtual in July. Everyone was, of course, in the same scenario of how do we move this in-person event to a virtual experience. So I'm happy to say that we absolutely crushed it on these projects. I hired an incredible team. We pivoted these events virtual, including the National Charter Schools Conference, which had more than 2,500 participants as well. A gala for the National Italian American Foundation. Again, usually an incredible star-studded black tie gala in Washington, DC, that this year had also, ironically, the year prior already chosen to honor Dr. Fauci at this event and couldn't be more timely to honor him this October at this gala. So it was actually pretty incredible to work on something for someone I consider a real hero for a lot of work he's done for a long time. And it was incredibly star-studded. And I've never done a gala like this. So it was absolutely incredible. And we created a dazzling virtual experience they loved like none other. And we also helped pivot other events that were planned to be in-person experiences virtually by using Zoom in ways others have never done before, by making things holistic experiences and creating real, meaningful, engaging events. Now, that was plenty about me. I say all this to say your future is your unique path. I tapped into my own personal past experience, challenged myself, learned new things, worked real hard at it, and had an incredible year. It was a lot of work, it was a lot of luck, but it was also a lot of manifesting my dreams and desires and goals that I had prior set. So your superpower can also drive your success. I'm not a wealthy person. I never expected to work in business, much less start my own business. So let's talk a little bit about digging into your past, figuring out what it is that you've done that connects to where you are now, and harness the power of your why to really superpower your career. You can do this. This is only unique to you. You are also, no one else has your story and perspective. And I share my story to illustrate the fact that you can do this. So let's talk about tapping into and, most importantly, articulating your superpower. Number one, find your why. Now, has anyone here found their why already? You could say yes in the chat or raise your hand. Okay, great. We've got some whys here. I'm so excited to see it. That's wonderful. Now, the thing about your why that's great is it likely won't change over years. You may refine it. You may use some different words. But the real driver is likely not going to change from one year to the next. So think about what drives you. Those of you that have your why, you are good here, and you can refine your why if you want, you know, spend a little time on it. A great way to do that is to share it with others, but really dig into your past, find your stories. What are those high moments and low moments you experienced in your life, and how did they shape you? Dig into your childhood, dig into your early career experiences, dig into those hopes and dreams, those things that really shaped you. Find those patterns in your life. You'll see exactly what it is that you kind of keep going back to. Then start drafting your why statement. Simon Sinek has fantastic tools, TED Talks, workbooks, workshops, even pay what you will classes to help find your why and to refine and practice your why. So they just launched those refine and practice your why classes as a pay what you will. So I've done these a few times. They're fantastic. And I will admit I've paid $0. I'm bad, but you can too. I'm a huge fan of his and I do buy his books. So I feel like I'm not the worst, but you know, take advantage, do what you can. If it's pay what you will and don't pay. So if you need a formula to blank, so that blank. So to action verb, to do something so that something happens. So refine that, try to make it punchy and memorable. And again, there's plenty of resources out there to help you with that. Couldn't recommend Simon Sinek enough. You've already heard my why. It's not in that formula, and that's okay, because I've played with this a few times and I'm still gonna keep refining this. But I do deeply believe events are rare opportunities to step out of our busy lives, grow, learn, reflect, and develop lasting connections. My purpose in life is to create those spaces in engaging, meaningful, purposeful ways that empower, elevate, and inspire others. And access couldn't be more important to that. Now, my business why is actually extremely close to my personal why. No surprise. At Aaron Leonard Events, we create memorable experiences designed to engage and delight. We use events to create a brief oasis in a busy, often hectic world. We believe in creating lasting connections through meaningful moments. And this is exactly how we do it. And we do it with events, but we also do it with websites and social media. So that's the thing, this why, this larger purpose, it transcends even what we do or how we do it. It's deeper than that. And we can take it in many different directions. It's how we've started a speakers bureau. It's how we've started our own events. It's actually funny that we started out by creating websites, even though we're an event company. Because part of events is, of course, marketing them, sharing them, creating websites for them. People need the information. So there's a lot of connected needs, skills, business opportunities for you that are deeply connected to your why that you may not think are, you know, exactly what you're going to do to make money. So find your why. Think about what drives you, what will drive others to find you. Why is it that you're doing all of this? And it's really that kind of nexus of what do you like to do and what are you good at? You want to create both of those lists and find those few things that are on both. So then you want to understand why you, what makes you special? What is it your secret gift and superpower? once you have that, we can really turbocharge your career, your business. And let's just say, when you start a business, or even if you just start as a freelancer, when you go out on your own, that is taking a career leap like none other. That is so much more than someone bestowing a title upon you that, of course, you've earned, but you've probably already been doing the job before you even got the title change. By going out on your own and landing work and managing it and doing it, you are doing more in a day than you would ever get the chance to do in a regular day-to-day job. So just remember that too, that when you self-anoint yourself as that founder or CEO, just like I did, it can feel really weird. You can definitely experience that imposter syndrome. But you know, you got this, you can do this. No one else has what you can do. And it's just about bringing it all to life, doing exactly what you would do at another job, but in a more holistic presence. So after you have your why, get yourself out there. You're gonna wanna share your why, talk about it, get it out there, make a website. It really doesn't need to be stellar to start, but it should be stellar at some point. So there's a lot of great tools out there. Squarespace in particular, I'm a huge fan of. Now, if you're an e-commerce person, you may want to look at Shopify outright. I recommend those two. I don't really recommend others. Happy to talk about why. Get your social, you know, apparatus in order. Make sure that you're putting your social efforts into where your network is. And if that network is people you're leveraging that you already know, because you don't necessarily have a network, you might want to just start with LinkedIn or Facebook. I started with LinkedIn and Instagram because I'm 34 and I spend all my time on Instagram, but my network is actually on LinkedIn. So get out there and do it in a way that's also fun to you. Instagram's also fun to me. LinkedIn less so, that's for business purposes, but get out there, talk about it. Okay. It can be uncomfortable tooting your own horn, but you have to do it. And if you can't do it, get somebody else to do it for you. So get in touch and leverage your network. For me, that was a newsletter and LinkedIn posts, a Facebook presence, an Instagram presence. And you can have reasonable goals to start. Try to update your whatever social channel or channels you're going to use. I would say don't start with too many, maybe just two or one. Update them weekly. If you can do two times a week, great. But whatever it is, make sure it's something that you can sustain. Do it every time, every week at that day, you know, or if you're gonna do it twice a week, the same days, every week at the same time, write that content to have it out there. On your website, start a blog, because the best part is your blog can drive people back to your website. When you share those LinkedIn posts, you can just say, hey, check out our new article on our website. Here's a link. They click on the blog link, boom, they're on your website. And that's where you want them to be. You want them to see your services. You want them to see what you're putting out there, what you want to do and your superpower. So leverage your network, tell your families, your friends, your neighbors. I'll say, I mean, I live in DC, but my neighbors are pretty amazing and it turns out pretty well connected. So I've gotten some incredible work from literally talking to people while walking my dog. So highly recommended. I know I'm an extrovert, not everybody is, but get yourself out there, talk about it to manifest it. It's the only way people will know you're open for business or seeking work or what you do. And come to find out, one of my neighbors is a rocket scientist. Had no idea, should have known from the fact that his dog's name was Newton, like Sir Isaac Newton. So get in touch, leverage your network, and eventually you're going to land your first or 100th, you know, depending on where you are in this process, client. It's going to happen. Just don't stop. And yes, of course, if you have to take on work at a lower budget, do the assessment. Does it help you achieve your goals? Does it get you where you want to be? Is it going to help give a portfolio, experience, skills that will help you get the next thing? Then it might be worth it, even if it's not really going to help pay the bills. Again, you got to have a little bit of that cushion or some kind of safety net or a job or some other thing to do so that you do keep the lights on. consider how, oh, another idea is consider reaching back to past employers or even your current employer. Would they be open to you in a consulting capacity? Would they be open hiring you on a project to project basis or moving you to part-time or even 3 or 4 days a week so that you can dedicate 1 or 2 full days to your job? Reach out to past employers, past colleagues, past friends. Get yourself out there professionally. Go out on those limbs. It'll feel weird, but the more you do it, the easier it is. And the best part is that you're not actually trying to sell yourself. You're not trying to say, hire me now. You're trying to say, hey, I'm doing this. Just get it out there. That will lead to work. Then you're going to want to set goals and track them. So vision your future. What are your 2021 goals? What is your best, your most creative year ever? What does that mean for you, of course, professionally, but also personally? What does your best year ever look like? Paint the picture. What is it? How are you spending your time? How much time are you spending at home? With what quality time are you having with the people in your home life? What quality time are you getting with yourself to pursue new hobbies, interests? What does it mean for you personally? Is it getting out of debt? Is it perhaps having a plan to get out of debt in 5 years? Is it perhaps just waking up every day, excited, motivated, ready to do something? Paint the picture of your greatest year and then ask yourself, what would have to be true in order to make this happen? If you can, vision this in 5 years, 10, 20, go crazy. And again, consider, what does this mean for me? Of course, professionally, but also personally, because you are more than just a worker. You are more than just a business owner. You're creative. Non-creatives don't always have this power, but you can make art. You can make incredible things. But you do need to also harness that time for yourself so that you can continue to be creative in ways outside of work. That's going to be crucial. I am a huge fan of Michael Hyatt and Company's Fully Focused Planner. I'm actually in their Business Accelerator community as well, which is a coaching program that is a subscription that I paid for actually early in 2020. Actually, no, I joined in September. It just feels like I've been there forever because it's been so good. So I had the money to invest that at the time. I highly recommend it, but you can start with something as simple as just these planners. Again, I don't get paid by them. I just found that it helped me write down my goals and then manage how I'm spending my time every single day to achieve those goals. So after you kind of get a vision, put yourself out there, you know, set yourself up, and then you land your first client. This is really, really crucial. You need to execute really, really, really well. Now, the good news here is that you will. Like I said, you're tapping into your superpowers. You know this. You're creative. You're a problem solver. You have experience, energy, wisdom. You have the connections. This client has trusted you. And there's a reason. You're going to rock it. But don't screw this up. Don't kill yourself either, but especially your first couple of projects, your first project, your second project, your first big project, or your first other kind of project. Do your damned best. Give it the focus it needs. Give it the energy. Give it the attention. Don't feel like you have to go out of scope or go beyond reason, but do exceed expectations. Do keep that client happy. Don't go over budget. Take it from me. Get the help you need. There's a lot of people out there that need help. And hopefully, again, you're landing too much work at some point. There's going to be a point where you say, oh my God, I haven't showered in days and I forgot to eat dinner and lunch 3 days in a row. Yep, that happened to me around December 26th last year. Yes, I worked through the holidays last year. Not recommended. That happened to me. And in January, I got a temp to help. And it changed my life. I mean, and again, night and day. Now, I didn't keep that temp. It wasn't actually the right fit, but it was incredible to have someone to get some more help and delegate tasks to. And it was someone that I could afford. So you also need to find someone that you can afford, get the contractors, vendors, the temporary support you need. It's going to take a while. Also, finding the right people certainly takes work. But keep going and know that you still have to manage them, even if they're vendors, even if they're contractors. You're going to have to make time to give them feedback. So sorry, we have a delivery. One second. Sorry, folks. So execute your best work ever. Make sure to go above and beyond. Keep that client happy because you want to get that word of mouth. You want to boldly brag about that work. You want to show it off. You want that client to show it off. Heck, you want them to hire you again or tell their best friend when you need a website, this is who you go to. Keep in mind that that is your marketing. That's your portfolio. That's establishing your brand and who you are. And that experience, that word of mouth, that reputation, that deliverable, whatever you just did, that is what's going to speak for you and for your company and for what you do more than anything you say or anything that you show, because that's really what you do. So have happy clients, let them spread the word, and focus on getting the work you want. So especially if it's work you love doing, that's where you're going to want to, you know, plant the seed or even ask them, could you give me a quote? Would you mind recommending me to others? Would you mind, here's a LinkedIn post. Would you mind tagging me in it to let people know I made your website? I'm at, you know, it's a new business. I'm just trying to grow it. So again, seeking work, selling work can be as simple as, hey, can you just talk about that? Hey, I know you like that. Could you just share it? You're not necessarily asking people to hire you. You are just asking them to authentically talk about the great experience they had. It's incredible. Again, that leads to work. And it's not an uncomfortable conversation to say, hey, could you please let people know I do this? They want to tell people. So get the help you need. Remember, you need to manage them. Learn, grow, get better. If you don't, and the more you do this, the more you will be able to keep doing the work you love and never have to go back to a job you don't want, never have to take on things you don't want to do or clients you don't want. You'll get to work with the people you want to work with. And that gets to the next critical point, which is when you're there, you got to grow your team in order to develop your unique style. So hire the right team. They might just be contractors. They might just be consultants. That's okay. Grow with them. Grow at the scale you can. Afford the people you can. And often I find what works best is finding great contractors to support on a project and then working with them more and more regularly. Sometimes they don't want to necessarily have other clients. They would rather become your go-to consultant or contractor or eventually a full-time employee. That's golden because they're building the future they want to have. And you're able to grow together into a group why. So that's just it. You want to find people that align to your why, that it resonates with them, that have their own why. And they may not have it when you hire them, but you want to help them find it. You want to grow with them. You want to tap into their strengths, their interests, their network. You want them bragging about what they've worked on. You want them bragging about you. And you want this to come from an authentic place. And whenever you can, focus your time on achieving your goals. Use your time to the fullest extent. Outsource, automate, or eliminate anything that you can. For me, that meant accounting. Now, accounting is I have to do plenty of it still, but it is outsourced. I send invoices, I check on budgets, I work on my annual, you know, budget, I review reports, but I don't reconcile things. I don't code expenses because they literally make me cry. HR is something I just don't have a skill set in. There's companies out there to hire that. Marketing, websites, again, build your own, do your own if you're a marketing company like I am, or get the help you need. It can be pretty easy to find folks dedicated to that. And then if you build it for yourself, you can also do it for others. So consider after you do something for your own business, making that a service you offer to others if you feel that it was a good thing you'd like to do again. So this will help you establish your unique style and then keep going. Keep the good people, the good clients, the good work. Keep those clients coming back. Move on from the bad. You know, bad things happen. Reflect, grow, learn from them. Journal your mistakes if you can. Remember that if you're not failing, you're not learning. So don't be afraid to fail, but when you do, make sure to write it down, reflect, even with core members of your team or your entire team, do something like an after action review. Understand individually, but also as a group, where did we go wrong? How did we stumble? What lessons did we learn? what do we want to do again? What do we want to keep from this? Like, what was good that we learned, that we either learned or we did right? And how do we want to not, what do we not want to repeat? So document that, learn from it, grow, try not to make those mistakes again. But of course you might. I've made a lot of mistakes more than once, and I've lived to tell the tale. You will too. Get more clients, make more money, have a more steady business. As a group, grow bigger, better, stronger. Work as a team to define what is your team why. So my team, what we just did at the end of this past year was we each had a retreat before the holidays. And we had about a 2-hour long team retreat where we reflected on the year. We talked about the highs, the lows. We each wrote our individual whys. So we all took the Simon Sinek class before, shared our individual whys, and then left with the charge to rewrite our company why in the new year. So when we come back in January, towards the end of the month, we're going to retreat again, this time for only about an hour or so, reconnect, set our goal, discuss our individual goals for the year, set team goals for the year, and tackle our first draft of our new team why, which I couldn't be more excited about. I am delighted to be able to have a team. It's so much more powerful than being an individual. I am a social person. I love working with other people. I also know my own limits and strengths. So I also love hiring and working with people that have strengths where I have weaknesses. That has been an incredible way to A, do what I want to do, and B, have success in even the things I'm not necessarily good at. That's the power of a team. So much stronger together. So work as a team, define your team why, and don't forget to keep learning. Read books, listen to books. I love Brené Brown on leadership, Simon Sinek on the infinite game for mindset and how to approach how you do work. There's so many more great books out there. I had an Audible subscription for about a year and crushed through like every conceivable business book because I don't have an MBA. Heck, I don't even have a business undergrad degree. So it was a lot of fun for me walking my dog, listening to business podcasts and business audio books. And then, you know, now feeling like I have an MBA. I might as well. I've listened to enough audio books. But I'm just kidding. But consider joining a coaching program if you can. And if you can't, there's plenty of great folks likely in your network that can offer you strength or feedback or wisdom or help you with your why. Maybe read your why to a few trusted friends or colleagues or mentors and see if that resonates. If you're stuck on your why, ask those people, what is it I do really well that no one else can do? And they'll tell you. That's the thing. It's a lot easier to do for someone else than yourself. So leverage your network. If you can join a coaching program, they're great. I've been in Michael Hyatt's program for a while. Again, I don't get any funding from this. I should be an affiliate, it sounds like, but it's really helped me focus on how I spend my time, how I focus my energy, how I set and achieve goals. And it's given me access to a community of other business leaders where we have monthly retreats and masterminds and whatnot, where we actually do group problem solving, where we each bring an individual problem. And we work in a mini group where different folks offer different solutions. It's actually pretty empowering and incredible because even little old me, little girl in her 30s that just started her own business less than a year ago, I have advice I can give people. And I didn't feel qualified at first, but it's incredible that I go to these masterminds and people I get paired up with absolutely love working with me and talking to me because I have unique skills, experience, problem solving, creativity, and energy that they don't necessarily have. And there are so many different industries and fields out there. It can be easy to forget that we do know interesting things, but because they've become so day-to-day or so normal in our lives, they don't seem exceptional anymore. But you are exceptional. You have a superpower. Consider joining your industry's professional organization, attending all kinds of online learning and events. We know there's a heck of a lot of them out there right now, and Content Academy has so much more good stuff to come. Don't work too hard. You don't want to burn yourself or your team out. Now that said, you do want to kill it on those few key projects. So put those extra hours in when they really, really matter. Be careful not to give up your entire life because life is actually what's happening outside of work. But I get it. We all need a job in order to have a life. you'll also do better work when you're not too burned out. And I, you know, strongly encourage you to find some hobbies or interests. I just started pottery right after Thanksgiving. I'm absolutely loving it. I'm making bowls and vases, and it's actually a great COVID activity because it's very, the air is filtered. It's all very like spread out in a warehouse. So that has really been amazing for me. I also absolutely love plants. This is also what led to the pottery need, was falling in love with plants over quarantine. There's so many things out there. I love art. I love to draw. This has been a cool thing I got over the break, paint by sticker, which is some serious detail work. You get these stickers and then you turn them into masterpieces. Again, I'm a creative, so I love these things. I'm not very detail-oriented, so this has been a little hard. But find your hobbies, find your interests, fuel your soul, okay? Because it can be really hard to get this thing off the ground. I spent the past year working a lot of extra hours, and the one thing I regret is that I didn't give enough time to my non-work life. So that's one of my big goals for the year, is to keep myself, of course, my day-to-day is very creative at work, but I want to be creative outside of that. I want to make art. I want to be around artists and communities. So I'm doing that with my pottery. I'm absolutely loving it. And I hope you can find something too. There's even like pottery at home over Zoom. Who knows? You will, if you don't have something, I strongly encourage you to find something or just try different things until something clicks. And who knows, what you work on your non-work time may actually lead to some incredible insights for your business, for your work, and even connections for business partners, potential clients that you meet in an authentic, genuine capacity that you're able, that then connects back to your work. So don't forget that the rest of life is also extremely important and has a lot of potential to influence your work and your day-to-day. Last few notes here. Don't be afraid to fail. You're failing, you're learning. It's true. Share your wisdom and inspire somebody else. That's the catch of success. Check in on your goals daily if you can. Again, that's why I like that planner so much. It's got goals at the front and even has like habit trackers so that if you do something like exercise, you can check it off every day you do it to make sure you're doing it. Also has achievement goals. It also reminds you to set rewards for when you achieve those goals. So check in on those goals and make sure your time is spent actually achieving those goals. Outsource, automate, get rid of things that really get in the way of you doing your best work as much as you can. And put time on your calendar for work that moves your goals forward. So schedule that time in your week to actually work on those goals and just work on the most simple steps. Start simple to achieve those goals. But more than anything else, remember that you are the only one with your skills, your experience, and your perspective. You have a superpower. Use it. All right. Well, that was it. I so appreciate all of you for your time and energy. I hope that you're jazzed and ready to go. And Scott, I would love to know if folks have any questions.
Yes. Aaron, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That was fantastic. We loved your energy. We loved your vulnerability. Thank you for kind of getting vulnerable with us and sharing some stuff that I think is really helpful. I mean, hey, I even wrote down some notes and I wasn't expecting that, so I appreciate that, and definitely some stuff that we can use, actionable ideas that we can use to make 2021 most creative year ever. So thank you. Lots of positive feedback. I think there's a lot to digest, so I see a lot of questions, but if anyone would like to pop on and ask a question, we have about 5 minutes, and then we're going to start our next session. So let me check the Facebook chat. Also, I have a giveaway, a door prize. So
exciting.
Yeah, Aaron, if you could help me give away a door prize here, that would be great. Yes. Basically, we're going to give away a VIP pass to Creative Your Ever right now. And with the VIP ticket, you get access to the VIP Zoom, which we have many people in the VIP Zoom right now, which hello, everyone in the Zoom. You get a printed copy of the Creative Your Ever Activation Journal and Workbook. By the way, I'm a huge fan of Michael Hyatt, too. I definitely have not gotten the Full Focus Planner, but we should look into that. I'm definitely going to look into that. But this is another type of tool that you can use to sort of calibrate your goals through the entire year. It's a $19 value. And most importantly, you get access to all the recordings of the sessions that went all weekend. So if you missed yesterday, or you missed a session, or you just can't watch it because you got something going on this weekend, you can watch them at your leisure with the VIP ticket. So it's just $25, but we're going to give away one right now. So I'm going to put it into my special algorithm here. Let's see here. For those of you who want more. Who want to get involved with the door prizes, the best way to win is to be active and ask questions. And it looks like our door prize winner today is Tamara Williams. Tamara Williams, Woo! You just won a VIP upgrade. Tamara, contact me, and I'll get you the information and send you the Zoom link. You can email us at team@careeryourever.com. All right, Aaron, thank you so much for hanging. I hope you can hang out with us more this weekend.
Totally.
But it's time now to start to welcome our next presenter. Our next presenter, Aaron, I'm sorry, any final thoughts before?
Thank you so much for having me. I thank you, everyone, for showing up. I believe in you. You've got your superpower, and I'm so excited to see what you make in your most creative year ever. And please get in touch. My name is out there, Aaron Leonard Events, such a creative name. Hop on the website, shoot me an email, you know, happy to keep the conversation going. And thank you so much, Scott, for this inspiring, exciting event. I'm definitely sticking around and taking my own notes because, you know, we made it. This is 2021 and I can't wait to make this a better year.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Hey, Aaron, I met you through an event. Do you have any events coming up?
Oh yeah, we've got a ton of events coming up. We have actually, we're doing our own speaker showcase at the end of January where we're showing off all of our Launchpad speakers. We have about 20 different speakers that are all new up and coming speakers that have incredible expertise, but are also incredibly engaging virtually. I might be just one of them. And we'll be doing a showcase where they're each giving their best content. So we'll do that at the end of the month, but we're also gonna share those clips to social and whatnot so that we'll be getting that out for the rest of the year and sharing some great stuff. But thanks for asking, Scott.
Cool. All right. So, and people can find that at AaronLeonardEvents.com, right?
That's right.
Awesome. Thank you, Aaron. And I'm interested in the speaker showcase, so I will definitely check that out. Thank you. All right. Our next speaker.